of giving. The reading that we had just a moment ago said that David is saying, "What shall I render to the Lord for all of his benefits toward me?" I think this is a question that every Christian needs to ask himself. What does the Lord require of us? What does the Lord expect of us? What shall I render unto the Lord? As one looks back to the Old Testament, we understand that under the Old Testament, they were commanded to give 10% of that which they had. They really were to give more than that. But there was the 10% tithe that they gave into the service of the Lord. And while we are not under the Old Testament today, there's no indication that we should give less than they gave under the Old Testament law. We are under a better covenant, under a better law. We ought to appreciate the things that God has done for us. We ought to be people that recognize the importance of giving. May I say, in connection with the Old Testament and the giving of the 10%, which was commanded under the law of Moses, it didn't really just begin with the law of Moses. Moses had not been born, had not been thought of, when Abraham gave a tenth part of all. God had promised that he would bless Abraham. If you look at Genesis chapter 12, it says, "The Lord said unto Abraham, Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house, and I will make thee a great nation. I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless them, thee, and curse them that curseth thee." We find Abraham got up and promised and went out looking for a city which hath the foundation, whose builder and maker was God. And God blessed him exceedingly. He became a very, very wealthy individual during the years because God blessed Abraham and Lot, his nephew, to the point that they could not even dwell together because of the size of their flocks and of their herds. Looking on a little further in the book of Genesis, we find that As we get to the 28th chapter of the book of Genesis, here is Jacob and Esau and the enmity between these two sons and their jealousy among them. And we find that Jacob tricked his father into giving him the blessing, to giving him the blessing of the birthright, which wasn't really to be his. With the help of his mother, they tricked the old man who couldn't see, and we find that he had to leave. He was fleeing from Esau because he was afraid Esau would kill him. But if you get down in this chapter, there's an interesting thing happened. It says, "Jacob went out to Beersheba and went toward Haran, and he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. He took stones that were in the place and put them for a pillar down at the place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending upon it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. The land whereon thou liest will I give it to thy seed." God had promised to bless him as he went away. Looking on down in this, we find Jacob wakening out of his dream, realizing, he says, "I am in the house of the Lord. I'm in an area where the Lord is, and I knew it not." He makes a vow. He vows a vow unto God. It says, "Jacob rose up early in the morning, took a stone and put it for a pillar, and set it upon for a pillar, and poured oil upon the top of it, and called the name of the place Bethel, but the name of the city was Luz. And Jacob vowed a vow, saying, If the Lord will be with me, and will keep me in this way that I go, I will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God, and this stone which I have set up for a pillar shall be the house of God, and all that thou shalt give me," notice what he says, "all that thou shalt give me, I will give a tenth unto thee." He is promising to God, if God will bless him, that he will give a tenth of all. Abraham earlier had, when he came back from the battle of the kings to rescue Lot, his nephew, he gave a tenth part of all to Melchizedek, priest of God Most High. All of this is before the law of Moses and before the Ten Commandments. Of course, during the Ten Commandments, they had to give that tenth part, and there were other sacrifices also that it was necessary for them to give. But we live under a better covenant today, and the Lord commands us to give as we have been prospered. I hope you've been thinking about how much God has prospered you and the kind of appreciation that needs to characterize all of us in our giving to do what the Lord would have us to do. The Lord watches the giving. The Bible teaches that the Lord was sitting over in the temple. He was sitting over against the treasure when the poor widow came and cast in her mite. She had very little. It was the smallest coin among the Jews at that time. But the Lord said with regard to her, she hath given more than they all. He wanted his disciples to see this and commended her because of the kind of sacrifice, because she gave everything she had. She gave her living. Most of us would have said to her, don't do that. God doesn't need your little sacrifice. You need it worse than he does. The Lord did not try to stop her. He commended her for what she was doing. And we need to recognize that we need also to make sacrifices, whether poor or rich or wherever we may stand along the way. In Mark chapter 8 and verse 36, we find it saying, what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? The Bible teaches that we are not to lay up for ourselves treasures here upon the earth, but lay up for ourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust doth not corrupt, and thieves do not break through and steal. We're to be people that seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then he says, all of these things shall be added unto you. With regard to the church, we find the statement in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, as Paul says, as I gave order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. The Lord commanded them to give. They continued in that kind of way in the early church. You find them coming together, continuing the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and breaking of bread and prayers. And this involves the acts of worship, which involved also the matter of giving of their means into the service of the Lord. Acts 20 and verse 35 says, it is more blessed to give than to receive. In fact, it points out that that was the words of the Lord Jesus. He says, to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said it's more blessed to give than to receive. Jesus also was the one who said, give, and this is Luke 6 and verse 38, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men give into your bosom. We are to make the kind of sacrifices to support the work of the Lord, to support good works, to do those things that the Lord would have us to do. In 2 Corinthians 8, we find it speaking with regard to the church in Macedonia. Here was a great congregation of the Lord's people, and when the church in Jerusalem was in need of help because of a great famine that was there, the Bible says that these people in Macedonia, out of their deep poverty, gave not just as they had been requested by the apostle to give, but gave, first of all, they gave themselves, he said, to us and to the Lord. They gave first themselves, and that's the real answer. It's not just a matter of giving our money. God wants not our money, but he wants us, and we are to be willing to understand that we need to use those things that God has given, and he is able to multiply our seed for sowing and bless us in ways that we do not understand or appreciate that he is able to bless us. So we're told that we're to give in the ninth chapter of 2 Corinthians. We're to give not only as we prospered, but we're to be people that are a cheerful giver. The Lord loveth a cheerful giver. As we consider the matter just in a moment with regard to what we are going to put down as what we will be giving for the year that lies out before us, I want you to look at the purpose card that is there and just what it says. It says, unless hindered in some unforeseen way, I or we purpose to give into the treasure of the South Florida Avenue Church of Christ in Lakeland, Florida during this year, the sum of so much per week, whatever that amount may be. to be used in carrying out the yearly program of the church. I understand I may increase or decrease. This is not a binding contract. It's simply that the elders need to know how to plan. They need to know what they can depend upon. The statement in 2 Corinthians 9:7 down below at the bottom of the card says, "Every man, according as he hath purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly nor of necessity." These brethren in Macedonia had purposed way in advance. They had purposed a year in advance, and that's the kind of thing that we are encouraging people to do. I believe it is a biblical concept. It is something that is helpful far as the planning and the ongoing of the Lord's work, and that's what we're encouraging people to do. And so as we think with regard to all of this, may I suggest to you that there are needs that we have, that our young people, that the various programs that missionaries have, that the Florida School of Preaching has. The Florida School of Preaching is in its 46th year. Part of the reason that it's able to do what it does is because of the sacrifices made by the congregation here. We are by far the largest donator to the work of educating and equipping these men for the work that they go forth to do. And God help us to continue to do the kind of work that is being done in that great way. There are needs, continually there are needs. Now I know somebody says, the church is always needing something. That's right. Someone observed in that connection, he said, I had a son one time that was like that. He was always needing something. He was needing money for pencils and papers and for the work at school. He was needing money for various other things. And he said, he hasn't needed anything for a long time. You see, my son, he said, is dead. I wish he were able to need something. Now, the point of that is, as long as the church is alive, the church will need things. When the church is dead, it won't need anything. We need to keep things alive. We need to keep the work of missions alive. We need to keep the work with the young people and the school of preaching and all of these things alive. God will bless our efforts and bless our labors. God help us to have the right kind of attitude to make the kind of sacrifices that we need. Now, as we think about this work, we may ask ourselves, well, can we do it? Are we able to accomplish what is outlined in this? Are we able to do all of that and send these young people into the work that they will be doing in the mission trip? Are we able to accomplish all these things? Can we do it? May I say to you that we are able, we are really able to do it. I'll tell the story that I've told before. I like the story. I like to hear it. If you've heard it, just don't let that bother you. If you haven't heard it, I want you to hear it. About the old man that was a wise old man, had a reputation for that. And the young men, were going to trick the old man. They said, we're going to show them he's not as wise as he thinks he is. And so they said, we get this bird. We have this bird, and we're going to take the bird in our hands and say, old man, I have a bird in my hands. Tell me, old man, is it alive or is it dead? And if he says it's alive, we'll crush it, and he'll be wrong. And if he says it's dead, we'll turn it loose and let it fly, and he'll be wrong. We'll prove him wrong. And the old man said, it is as you will. And that's right. This budget and the work of the Lord's church is as we will. God will bless our efforts, but we're going to have to make the sacrifices that are necessary. We need to learn to make those sacrifices because God will bless us in the doing of it. We're going to ask you in just a moment now to fill out the card. Before we fill out the card, let me urge you to think about it just for a moment. And first of all, let's have a moment of silent prayer. Will you bow together with us as we pray? Dear Father, we're so very thankful today that we can call upon Thee as our God and as our Father. We're thankful for the blessings that You have extended to us in the past. We're grateful, Father, for our health and well-being. We're grateful for our financial situations, that they are as well as they are. And above everything, we're grateful for the spiritual blessings we have in Christ Jesus. We pray, Father, that You will look down upon each of us this day as we ask the question, what shall I render unto the Lord for all of His blessings? Help us to make the decision that You would have us to make, to be sacrificial in our giving, and bless us in the doing of it, and bless in the carrying out of those things that are for the ongoing and advancement of Your kingdom. Wouldst Thou watch over us this day and keep us in all the days before us. Through Jesus' name we ask, amen. And now will you fill out the card, put down how much you were willing to purpose, and then after you filled it out, turn the card over. It doesn't matter really whether or not you put your name on it or not, because it's not a binding contract, but the elders need to know how much. Turn the card over, and let's pass them to the aisles at this time. If you pass them to the aisles, we'll have these men who pass the booklets out and all of this to pass down the aisles and pick them up. If you feel that you need to talk to your wife or husband or whoever you need to talk to,